नमस्ते अरुण जेवी एंड डॉक्टर राकेश शर्मा प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑर्गेनम ऑफ मेडिसिन एंड होम्योपैथिक फिलोसॉफी होम्योपैथिक जो कि विद्यापीठ वुमेन्स यूनिवर्सिटी हियर आई वांट टू डिस्कस अपोरिज्म 115 दिस अपोरिज्म इज रिलेटेड टू पोसोलॉजी सॉरी I want to discuss aphorism 215. Just a minute. Last lecture, I discussed aphorism 249. Now 215. Sorry for inconvenience. Went to the observant practitioner to accurately investigate the states of the disease. It is evident in urgent cases after the lapse of only 6, 8 or 12 hours that he has made a bad selection in the medicine last year. In that the patient state is growing perceptibly, however slightly worse from hour to hour. By the occurrence of no symptoms and sufferings. It is not only allowable for him, but it is his duty to remedy his mistake by the selection and administration of a homeopathic medicine not merely tolerably suitable, but the most appropriate possible for the existing state of the disease. So Dr. Hinneman says in this algorithm, if after giving the medicine and there is no improvement and the patient condition becomes worse, becomes decline, then here is the time to change the remedy. Here it indicates the selection of our remedy is wrong and we have to select more appropriate homeopathic medicine for the case. There are some medicines like Ignatia, Bryonia, Rus, and Belladonna, whose power of altering man's health consists chiefly in altering actions, a kind of primary action, symptoms that are in part opposed to each other. Should the practitioner find on prescribing one of these, selected on strict homeopathic principles, that no improvement follows, he will in most cases soon effect his object by giving him in acute disease, even within a few hours, a fresh and equally small dose of the same medicine. What should we find during the employment of the other medicines in chronic diseases that the best selected homeopathic medicine in the suitable dose does not effect an improvement? This is a sure sign that the cause that keeps up the disease still persists and that there is some circumstances in the mode of life of the patient or in the situation in which he is placed that must be removed in order that a permanent cure may ensue. Among the signs that in all diseases, especially in such as are of an acute nature, inform us of a slight commencement of amelioration or aggravation that is not perceptible to everyone. The state of mind and the whole demeanor of the patient are the most certain and instructive. In the case of ever so slight an improvement, we observe a greater degree of comfort, increased calmness and freedom of the mind, higher spirits, a kind of return of the natural state. In the case of fever, so small a commencement of aggravation we have. On the contrary, the exact opposite of this, a constrained, helpless, pitiable state of the disposition of the mind, of the whole demeanor, and of all gestures, postures, and actions, which may be easily perceived on close observation, but cannot be described in words. The sign of improvement in the disposition and mind, however, may be expected only soon after the medicine has been taken, when the dose has been sufficiently minute. An unnecessary large dose of even the most suitable homeopathic medicine acts too violently and at first produces too great and too lasting a disturbance of the mind and disposition. Allow us soon to perceive the improvement in them. I must here observe that this so essential rule is chiefly transgressed by presumptuous trios in homeopathy and by physicians who are converted to homeopathy from the ranks of the old school. From the old prejudices, these persons uphold the smallest doses of the lowest dilutions of medicine in such cases, and hence they fail to experience the great advantages and blessings of that mode of proceeding, which a thousandfold experience has shown to be the most salutary. They cannot effect all that homeopathy is capable of doing, and hence they have no claim to be considered its adherents. The other new or increased symptoms, on the contrary, the diminution of the original ones without any addition of new ones, will soon dispel all doubts from the mind of the attentively observing and investigating practitioner with regard to the aggravation or amelioration. Though there are among patients persons who are either incapable of giving an account of this amelioration or aggravation, are unwilling to confess it. But even with such individuals, we may convince ourselves on this point by going with them through all the symptoms enumerated in our notes of the disease one by one, and finding that they complain of no new unusual symptoms in addition to these, and that none of the old symptoms are worse. If this be the case, and if an improvement in the disposition and mind have already been observed, the medicine must have effected positive diminution of the disease, or if sufficient time have not yet elapsed for this, it will soon effect it. Now, supposing the remedy is perfectly appropriate, if the improvement delays too long in making its appearance, this depends either on some error of conduct on the part of the patient or on the homeopathic aggravation produced by medicine lasting too long, consequently on the dose not being small enough. On the other hand, if the patient mentioned the occurrence of some fresh accidents and symptoms of importance, sign that the medicine chosen has not been strictly homeopathic, even though he should assure us that he feels better, we must not believe this assurance, but regard his state as aggravated, as it will soon be perfectly apparent. On the other hand, if the patient mentions the occurrence of some fresh accidents and symptoms of importance, sign that the medicine chosen has not been strictly homeopathic, even though he should good-natured assure us that he feels better, as is not infrequently the case in physical patients with lung abscess, we must not believe this assurance, but regard its state as aggravated, as it will soon be perfectly apparent. This is according to the 6th edition. The true physician will take care to avoid making favorite remedies of medicine, the employment of which he has by chance perhaps found often useful, and which he has had opportunities of using with good effect. If he do so, some remedies or rarer use which would have been more homeopathic and suitable, consequently more serviceable, will often be neglected. The The true practitioner, moreover, will not in his practice with mistrustful weakness neglect the employment of those medicines that he may now and then have employed with bad effects, owing to an erroneous selection, or avoid them for other reasons, as that they were unhomeopathic for the case of disease before him. You must bear in mind the truth, that of medicinal agents, that one alone invariably deserves the preference in every case of disease which corresponds most accurately by similarity to the totality of the characteristic symptoms, and that no prejudice should interfere with this serious choice. Considering the minuteness of the doses necessary and proper in homeopathic treatment, we can easily understand that during the treatment, everything must be removed from the diet and the regimen which can have any medicinal action, in order that the small dose may not be overwhelmed and extinguished or disturbed by any foreign medicinal irritants. There is a footnote, it is a problem. The surface bounce of a distant flu that in the still midnight hours would inspire a tender heart with exalted feelings and dissolve it in religious ecstasy are inaudible and powerless amid discordant cries and noises of the The careful investigation into such obstacles to cure is so much the more necessary in the case of patients affected by chronic disease, as their diseases are usually aggravated by such noxious influences and other disease-causing errors in the which often pass unnoticed, like the coffee, the fine Chinese and other herbs teas. Beer prepared with medicinal vegetable substances unsuitable for the patient's state. So called the fine liquors made with medicinal substances. Spiced chocolate, odorous waters, and perfumes of many kinds, strong scented flowers in the apartment, food powders and essences and perfumes, sachets compounded of drugs, highly spiced dishes and sauces, spiced cakes and ices, root medicinal vegetables for food, dishes of herbs, roots and stalks of plants possessing medicinal qualities. Old cheese and meats that are in a state of decomposition or that possess medicinal properties ought just as certainly to be kept from patients, as they should avoid all excesses in food and in the use of sugar and salt, as also spirituous drinks, heated rooms, woolen clothing, mats by skin, a sedentary life in close apartments, or the frequent indulgence in mere passive exercise, prolonged suckling, taking a long siesta in a recumbent posture in bed, sitting up long at night, uncleanliness, unnatural debauchery, innervation by reading obscene books, subjects of anger, grief or vexation, a patient for play, over-exertion of the mind or body, especially after meals, dwelling in bars in districts, damp rooms, penurious living, all these things must be as far as possible avoided or removed, in order that the cure may not be obstructed or rendered impossible. Some of my disciples seem needlessly to increase the difficulties of the patient's dietary by forbidding the use of many more tolerably indifferent things, which is not to be commended. This is part is related to diet and regimen. We have to follow these diet and regimen for the patient along with the prescribed medicine. Because without it, we never succeed in curing the patient. Here I am talking about especially in the chronic cases. In acute cases, there is no such restrictions. We can advise whatever patient wants to eat in acute conditions. But in chronic case conditions, we have to follow such guidelines. related to diet part of the patient. Because in diet, there are many food products which contain some medicinal qualities. So due to this, we have to stop such food articles, because due to these, our medicine's action becomes hindered. So thank you. If you have any query, please you can ask me.